This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Armenian Genocide Armenian, Hayek Sagaspanatun Hayat Sagaspanatun, Turkish, Ermeni Soykarimi, also known as the Armenian Holocaust, was the Ottoman government's systematic extermination of 15 million Armenians, mostly Ottoman citizens within the Ottoman Empire and its successor state, the Republic of Turkey. The starting date is conventionally held to be 24 April 1915, the day that Ottoman authorities rounded up, arrested, and deported 235 to 270 Armenian intellectuals and community leaders from Constantinople to Ankara, the majority of whom were eventually murdered. The genocide was carried out during and after World War I and implemented in two phases: the wholesale killing of the able-bodied male population through massacre and subjection of army conscripts to forced labor, followed by the deportation of women, children, the elderly, and the infirm on death marches leading to the Syrian desert driven forward by military escorts. The deportees were deprived of food and water and subjected to periodic robbery, rape, and massacre. Other indigenous and Christian ethnic groups such as the Assyrians and the Ottoman Greeks were similarly targeted for extermination by the Ottoman government in the Assyrian genocide and the Greek genocide, and their treatment is considered by some historians to be part of the same genocidal policy. Most Armenian diaspora communities around the world came into being as a direct result of the genocide. Raphael Lemkin was explicitly moved by the Armenian annihilation to define systematic and premeditated exterminations within legal parameters and to coin the word genocide in 1943. The Armenian Genocide is acknowledged to have been one of the first modern genocides, because scholars point to the organized manner in which the killings were carried out in order to eliminate the Armenians, and it is the second most studied case of genocide after the Holocaust. Turkey, the successor state of the Ottoman Empire, denies the word genocide as an accurate term for the mass killings of Armenians that began under Ottoman rule in 1915. It has in recent years been faced with repeated calls to recognize them as genocide. To date, 29 countries have officially recognized the mass killings as genocide, as have most genocide scholars and historians. Contents 1. Background: 11 Armenians under Ottoman rule, 12 reform implementation, 1840s to 80s, 13 Armenian National Liberation Movement, 14 Hamidian massacres, 1894-96-2 Prelude to the genocide, 21 The Young Turk Revolution of 1908. 22 The Adana Massacre of 1909-23 The Balkan Wars, 3 World War I, 31 Battle of Sarakamish, 32 Directive 8682, 25 February 33 Van, April 1915 34 Arrest and deportation of Armenian notables, April 1915 35 deportations, 351 death marches, 352 concentration camps, 36 confiscation of property, 361 international aid to victims, 37 The Special Organization, 38 Massacres, 381 Mass Burnings, 382 Drowning, 383 Use of Poison and Drug Overdoses, 39 Trials, 391 Turkish Courts Martial, 392 Detainees in Malta, 393 Trial of Sagaman Telerian, 4 Armenian Population, Deaths, Survivors, 1914-1923 5 Reports and Reactions, 51 The U.S. Mission in the Ottoman Empire, 511 Ambassador Morgenthau's Story, 52 Allied Forces in the Middle East, 521 Arnold Toynbee, The Treatment of Armenians, 53 Austrian and German Joint Mission, 531 Armin T. Wegner, 54 Ottoman Empire and Turkey, 55 Russian Military, 56 Scandinavian Missionaries and Diplomats, 57 Persia, 6 Studies on the Genocide, 61 Terminology, 7 Recognition of the Genocide, 71 Republic of Turkey and the Genocide, 711 Controversies, 72 The Republic of Armenia and the Genocide, 8 Cultural Loss, 9 Reparations to the Victims, 91 Reparations on the Grounds of International Law, 92 Sevres Treaty, 93 Lawsuits, 10 Commemoration, 101 Memorials, 102 Portrayal in the Media, 11 Images, 12 See Also, 13 Notes, 14 References, 15 Further Reading, 151 Historical Overviews, 152 Specific Issues and Comparative Studies, 153 Survivors' Testimonies and Memory, 154 Former Armenian Communities, 155 World Responses and Foreign Testimony, 156 Memory and Historiography, 16 External Links. Background: Main Articles, Armenians in the Ottoman Empire and Ottoman Armenian Population, Armenians under Ottoman Rule, the Western Portion of Historical Armenia, known as Western Armenia, Armenia, had come under Ottoman rule following the Peace of Amasya 1555 and decisively with the Treaty of Zuhab 1639 henceforth. The region was also alternatively referred to as Turkish Armenia or Ottoman Armenia. The vast majority of Armenians, grouped together under the name Armenian Millet Community and led by their spiritual head, the Armenian Patriarch of Constantinople, were mainly concentrated in the eastern provinces of the Ottoman Empire, although large communities were also found in the western provinces, as well as in the capital Constantinople. The Armenian community was made up of three religious denominations: Armenian Catholic, Armenian Protestant, and Armenian Apostolic, the religion of a vast majority of Armenians through the millet system. The Armenian community were allowed to rule themselves under their own system of governance with fairly little interference from the Ottoman government, with the exception of the empire's urban centers and the extremely wealthy, Constantinople-based Amira class, a social elite whose members included the Dujans directors of the Imperial Mint, the Balyans chief imperial architects, and the Dadians superintendent of the gunpowder mills and manager of industrial factories. Most Armenians, approximately 70% of their population, lived in poor and dangerous conditions in the rural countryside. Ottoman census figures clash with the statistics collected by the Armenian Patriarchate. According to the latter, there were almost 3 million Armenians living in the empire in 1878, 400,000 in Constantinople and the Balkans, 600,000 in Asia Minor and Cilicia, 670,000 in Lesser Armenia and the area near Kayseri, and 1,300,000 in Western Armenia itself in the eastern provinces. The Armenians were subject to the whims of their Turkish and Kurdish neighbors, who would regularly overtax them, subject them to brigandage and kidnapping, force them to convert to Islam, and otherwise exploit them without interference from central or local authorities in the Ottoman Empire. In accordance with the dhimmi system implemented in Muslim countries, they, like all other Christians and also Jews, were accorded certain freedoms. The dhimmi system in the Ottoman Empire was largely based upon the Pact of Umar. The client status established the rights of the non-Muslims to property, livelihood and freedom of worship, but they were in essence treated as second-class citizens in the empire and referred to in Turkish as gavers, a pejorative word meaning infidel or unbeliever. While the Pact of Umar prohibited non-Muslims from building new places of worship, it was not enforced in all regions of the Ottoman Empire since there were no laws concerning religious ghettos. The prohibition of non-Muslims building new places of worship led to their clustering around existing ones, writing in the late 1890s after a visit to the Ottoman Empire. The British ethnographer William Ramsay described the conditions of Armenian life as follows: "We must, however, go back to an older time, if we want to appreciate what uncontrolled Turkish rule meant. Alike to Armenians and to Greeks, it did not mean religious persecution, it meant unutterable contempt. Several prohibitions were placed on them. Their testimony against Muslims by Christians and Jews was inadmissible in courts of law wherein a Muslim could be punished. This meant that their testimony could only be considered in commercial cases. They were forbidden to carry weapons or ride atop horses and camels. Their houses could not overlook those of Muslims, and their religious practices were severely circumscribed, e.g., the ringing of church bells was strictly forbidden. Reform implementation, 1840s to 80s. Main article, Armenian question. German ethnographic map of Asia Minor and Caucasus in 1914. Armenians are labeled in blue in the mid-19th century. The three major European powers, Great Britain, France and Russia, began to question the empire's treatment of its Christian minorities and pressure it to grant equal rights to all its subjects from 1839 to the declaration of a constitution in 1876. The Ottoman government instituted the Tanzimat, a series of reforms designed to improve the status of minorities. Nevertheless, most of the reforms were never implemented because the empire's Muslim population rejected the principle of equality for Christians by the late 1870s. The Greeks, along with several other Christian nations in the Balkans, frustrated with their conditions, had, often with the help of the great powers, broken free of Ottoman rule. The Armenians remained, by and large, passive during these years, earning them the title of Millet-i Sadika or the Loyal Millet. In the mid-1860s and early 1870s, this passivity gave way to new currents of thinking in Armenian society led by intellectuals educated at European universities or American missionary schools in Turkey. Armenians began to question their second-class status and press for better treatment from their government. In one such instance, after amassing the signatures of peasants from Western Armenia, the Armenian Communal Council petitioned the Ottoman government to redress their principal grievances: the looting and murder in Armenian towns by Kurds and Circassians, improprieties during tax collection, criminal behavior by government officials, and the refusal to accept Christians as witnesses in trial. The Ottoman government considered these grievances and promised to punish those responsible, though no meaningful steps were ever taken. 36 Following the violent suppression of Christians in the uprisings in Bosnia and Herzegovina, Bulgaria and Serbia in 1875, the Great Powers invoked the 1856 Treaty of Paris by claiming that it gave them the right to intervene and protect the Ottoman Empire's Christian minorities. 35 FF Under growing pressure, the government of Sultan Abdul Hamid II declared itself a constitutional monarchy with a parliament which was almost immediately prorogued and entered into negotiations with the powers at the same time. The Armenian Patriarch of Constantinople, Nerses II, forwarded Armenian complaints of widespread forced land seizure into the sessions on the grounds that it did not represent a country confined to the periphery. The delegation did its best to contact the representatives of the powers and argue the case for Armenian administrative autonomy within the Ottoman Empire, but to little effect following an understanding reached with Ottoman representatives. Britain drew up an emasculated version of Article 16 to replace the original, a clause that retained the call for reforms but omitted any reference to the Russian occupation, thereby dispensing with the principal guarantee of their implementation. Despite an ambiguous reference to great power supervision, the clause failed to offset the removal of the Russian guarantee with any tangible equivalent, thus leaving the timing and fate of the reforms to the discretion of the Sublime Porte. 38, 39 The clause was readily adopted as Article 61 of the Treaty of Berlin on the last day of the Congress, to the deep disappointment of the Armenian delegation. Armenian National Liberation Movement. Main article, Armenian National Liberation Movement prospects for reforms faded rapidly following the signing of the Berlin Treaty, as security conditions in the Armenian provinces went from bad to worse and abuses proliferated. Upset with this turn of events, a number of disillusioned Armenian intellectuals living in Europe and Russia decided to form political parties and societies dedicated to the betterment of their compatriots in the Ottoman Empire in the last quarter of the 19th century. This movement came to be dominated by three parties: the Armenakan, whose influence was limited to Van, the Social Democrat Hunchakian Party, and the Armenian Revolutionary Federation. Dashniksushian ideological differences aside, all the parties had the common goal of achieving better social conditions for the Armenians of the Ottoman Empire through self-defense and advocating increased European pressure on the Ottoman government to implement the promised reforms. Hamidian massacres, 1894-96. Main article, Hamidian massacres. Corpses of massacred Armenians in Erzurum in 1895. Since 1876, the Ottoman state had been led by Sultan Abdul Hamid II. Immediately after the Treaty of Berlin was signed, Abdul Hamid attempted to forestall implementation of its reform provisions by asserting that Armenians did not make up a majority in the provinces and that their reports of abuses were largely exaggerated or false. In 1890, Abdul Hamid created a paramilitary outfit known as the Hamidia, which was mostly made up of Kurdish irregulars who were tasked to deal with the Armenians as they wished. 40 As Ottoman officials intentionally provoked rebellions, often as a result of overtaxation in Armenian-populated towns, such as in Sasan in 1894 and Zetun in 1895-96, these regiments were increasingly used to deal with the Armenians by way of oppression and massacre. In some instances, Armenians successfully fought off the regiments and in 1895 brought the excesses to the attention of the Great Powers, who subsequently condemned the Porte. 40-2 In October 1895, the Powers forced Abdul Hamid to sign a new reform package designed to curtail the powers of the Hamidia, but, like the Berlin Treaty, it was never implemented on 1 October 1895. 2,000 Armenians assembled in Constantinople to petition for the implementation of the reforms, but Ottoman police units converged on the rally and violently broke it up. 57-8 Soon, massacres of Armenians broke out in Constantinople and then engulfed the rest of the Armenian-populated provinces of Bitlis, Diyarbakir, Erzurum, Harput, Shivas, Trabzon, and Van. Estimates differ on how many Armenians were killed, but European documentation of the pogroms, which became known as the Hamidian massacres, placed the figures at between 100,000 and 300,000. Although Hamid was never directly implicated in ordering the massacres, it is believed that they had his tacit approval. 42 Frustrated with European indifference to the massacres, a group of members of the Armenian Serbian Revolutionary Federation seized the European-managed Ottoman Bank on 26 August 1896. This incident brought further sympathy for Armenians in Europe and was lauded by the European and American press, which vilified Hamid and painted him as the Great Assassin, Bloody Sultan, and Abdul the Damned, 35,115. While the great powers vowed to take action and enforce new reforms, these never came to fruition due to conflicting political and economic interests. Prelude to the Genocide Main Article, Dissolution of the Ottoman Empire. The Young Turk Revolution of 1908. Main Article, Young Turk Revolution. Armenians of Constantinople celebrating the establishment of the Cup government on 24 July 1908. Armenians' hopes for equality in the empire brightened once more when a coup d'état staged by officers in the Ottoman Third Army based in Salonika removed Abdulhamid II from power and restored the country to a constitutional monarchy. The officers were part of the Young Turk movement that wanted to reform administration of the perceived decadent state of the Ottoman Empire and modernize it to European standards. The movement was an anti-Hamidian coalition made up of two distinct groups, the liberal constitutionalists and the nationalists. The former were more democratic and accepting of Armenians, whereas the latter were less tolerant of Armenians and their frequent requests for European assistance. 142-1 in 1902, during a Congress of the Young Turks held in Paris, the heads of the liberal wing, Sabahattin and Ahmed Riza Bey, partially persuaded the nationalists to include in their objectives ensuring some rights for all the minorities of the empire. One of the numerous factions within the Young Turk movement was a secret revolutionary organization called the Committee of Union and Progress Cup. It drew its membership from disaffected army officers based in Salonika and was behind a wave of mutinies against the central government in 1908. Elements of the Third Army and the Second Army Corps declared their opposition to the Sultan and threatened to march on the capital to depose him. Hamid, shaken by the wave of resentment, stepped down from power as Armenians, Greeks, Assyrians, Arabs, Bulgarians and Turks alike rejoiced in his dethronement. 143-4 The Adana Massacre of 1909. Main Article, Adana Massacre. The Armenian quarter after the massacres in Adana in 1909, a countercoup took place in early 1909, ultimately resulting in the 31st of March incident on 13 April 1909. Some reactionary Ottoman military elements, joined by Islamic theological students, aimed to return control of the country to the Sultan and the rule of Islamic law. Riots and fighting broke out between the reactionary forces and Cup forces, until the Cup was able to put down the uprising and court-martial the opposition leaders. While the movement initially targeted the Young Turk government, it spilled over into pogroms against Armenians who were perceived as having supported the restoration of the constitution. 68-9 When Ottoman army troops were called in, many accounts record that instead of trying to quell the violence they actually took part in pillaging Armenian enclaves in Adana province. The number of Armenians killed in the course of the Adana massacre ranged between 15,000 and 30,000 people. 69 The Balkan Wars in 1912. The First Balkan War broke out and ended with the defeat of the Ottoman Empire as well as the loss of 85% of its European territory. Many in the empire saw their defeat as Allah's divine punishment for a society that did not know how to pull itself together. 84 The Turkish nationalist movement in the country gradually came to view Anatolia as their last refuge. That the Armenian population formed a significant minority in this region later figured prominently in the calculations of the three pashas, who carried out the Armenian genocide. An important consequence of the Balkan Wars was also the mass expulsion of Muslims known as Muhasirs from the Balkans beginning in the mid-19th century. Hundreds of thousands of Muslims, including Turks, Circassians, and Chechens, were expelled or forced to flee from the Caucasus and the Balkans. Rumelia as a result of the Russo-Turkish Wars and the conflicts in the Balkans. Muslim society in the empire was incensed by this flood of refugees. A journal published in Constantinople expressed the mood of the times: "Let this be a warning. Killings of the Armenians and the confiscation of their properties during the genocide, 86-87 World War I. See also, Middle Eastern Theater of World War I. On 2 November 1914, the Ottoman Empire opened the Middle Eastern Theater of World War I by entering hostilities on the side of the Central Powers and against the Allies. The battles of the Caucasus Campaign, the Persian Campaign and the Gallipoli Campaign affected several populous Armenian centers before entering the war. The Ottoman government had sent representatives representatives to the Armenian Congress at Erzurum to persuade Ottoman Armenians to facilitate its conquest of Transcaucasia by inciting an insurrection of Russian Armenians against the Russian army in the event a Caucasus front was opened. 136 Battle of Sarakamish. Main article, Battle of Sarakamish. See also, Caucasus campaign on 24 December 1914, Minister of War Enver Pasha implemented a plan to encircle and destroy the Russian Caucasus army at Sarakamish in order to regain territories lost to Russia after the Russo-Turkish War of 1877-78. Enver Pasha's forces were routed in the battle, and almost completely destroyed. Returning to Constantinople, Enver Pasha publicly blamed his defeat on Armenians in the region having actively sided with the Russians. 200 Directive 8682, 25 February. Further information, Ottoman Labor Battalions. On 25 February 1915, the Ottoman General Staff released the War Minister Enver Pasha's Directive 8682 on increased security and precautions to all military units, calling for the removal of all ethnic Armenians serving in the Ottoman forces from their posts and for their demobilization. They were assigned to the Unarmed Labor Battalions. Turkish, Emele Tabrulari. The directive accused the Armenian Patriarchate of releasing state secrets to the Russians. Enver Pasha explained this decision as out of fear that they would collaborate with the Russians. Traditionally, the Ottoman army only drafted non-Muslim males between the ages of 20 and 45 into the regular army. The younger 15-20 and older 45-60 non-Muslim soldiers had always been used as logistical support through the labor battalions before February. Some of the Armenian recruits were utilized as laborers hamals, though they would ultimately be executed. Transferring Armenian conscripts from active combat to passive, unarmed logistics sections was an important precursor to the subsequent genocide, as reported in the memoirs of Naim Bey. The execution of the Armenians in these battalions was part of a premeditated strategy of the CUP. Many of these Armenian recruits were executed by local Turkish gangs. 178. Van, April 1915. Further information, Siege of Van. Armed Armenian civilians and self-defense units during the Siege of Van in April to May 1915. On 19 April 1915, Cevdet Bey demanded that the city of Van immediately furnish him 4,000. Reports of the conflict reached then United States Ambassador to the Ottoman Empire Henry Morgenthau Sr. from Aleppo and Van, prompting him to raise the issue in person with Talat and Enver, as he quoted to them the testimonies of his consulate officials. They justified the deportations as necessary to the conduct of the war, suggesting that complicity of the Armenians of Van with the Russian forces that had taken the city justified the persecution of all ethnic Armenians. Arrest and deportation of Armenian notables, April 1915. Further information, deportation of Armenian intellectuals. On 24 April 1915, some Armenian intellectuals arrested on 24 April 1915, and following weeks, then deported and killed by 1914. Ottoman authorities had already begun a propaganda drive to present Armenians living in the Ottoman Empire as a threat to the Empire's security. An Ottoman naval officer in the War Office described the planning. In order to justify this enormous crime, the requisite propaganda material was thoroughly prepared in Istanbul. The Armenians are in league with the enemy. They will launch an uprising in Istanbul, kill off the Ittihadist leaders, and will succeed in opening up the straits. 220 Interior Minister Talat Pasha, who ordered the arrests. On the night of 23-24 April 1915, known as Red Sunday Armenian, Karmir Karaki Garmir Juragi, the Ottoman government rounded up and imprisoned an estimated 250 Armenian intellectuals and community leaders of the Ottoman capital, Constantinople, and later those in other centers, who were moved to two holding centers near Ankara. 211-2 This date coincided with Allied troop landings at Gallipoli after unsuccessful Allied naval attempts to break through the Dardanelles to Constantinople in February and March 1915. Following the passage of Tesser Law on 29 May 1915, the Armenian leaders, except for the few who were able to return to Constantinople, were gradually deported and assassinated. The date 24 April is commemorated as Genocide Remembrance Day by Armenians around the world. Deportations. Further information, Tesser Law. See also, Armenian Casualties of Deportations. Map of Massacre Locations and Deportation and Extermination Centers in May 1915. Mehmet Talat Pasha requested that the cabinet and Grand Vizier Said Halim Pasha legalize a measure for the deportation of Armenians to other places due to what Talat Pasha called the Armenian riots and massacres, which had arisen in a number of places in the country. However, Talat Pasha was referring specifically to events in Van and extending the Implementation to the regions in which alleged riots and massacres would affect the security of the war zone of the Caucasus campaign later. The scope of the deportation was widened in order to include the Armenians in the other provinces. The remains of Armenians massacred at Erzincan on 29 May 1915. The KUP Central Committee passed the Temporary Law of Deportation, Tesser Law, giving the Ottoman government and military authorization to deport anyone it sensed as a threat to national security. 186-8 headline of New York Times, December 15, 1915. With the implementation of Tesser Law, the confiscation of Armenian property and the slaughter of Armenians that ensued upon its enactment outraged much of the Western world, while the Ottoman Empire's wartime allies offered little protest. A wealth of German and Austrian historical documents has since come to attest to the witnesses' horror at the killings and mass starvation of Armenians, 329-31 to 212-3 in the United States. The New York Times reported almost daily on the mass murder of the Armenian people, describing the process as systematic, authorized, and organized by the government. Theodore Roosevelt would later characterize this as the greatest crime of the war. Historian Hans Lucas Kieser states that, from the statements of Talat Pasha, it is clear that the officials were aware that the deportation order was genocidal. Another historian, Taner Akkam, states that the telegrams show that the overall coordination of the genocide was taken over by Talat Pasha. Death marches: an Armenian woman kneeling beside a dead child in field within sight of help and safety at Aleppo. The Armenians were marched out to the Syrian town of Deir-e-Zor and the surrounding desert. There is no evidence that the Ottoman government provided the extensive facilities and supplies that would have been necessary to sustain the life of hundreds of thousands of Armenian deportees during their forced march to the Syrian desert or after by August 1915. The New York Times repeated an unattributed report that the roads and the Euphrates are strewn with corpses of exiles, and those who survive are doomed to certain death. It is a plan to exterminate the whole Armenian people. Talat Pasha and D. Jamal Pasha were completely aware that by abandoning the Armenian deportees in the desert they were condemning them to certain death. A dispatch from a high diplomatic source in Turkey, not American, reporting the testimony of trustworthy witnesses about the plight of Armenian deportees in northern Arabia and the lower Euphrates Valley was extensively quoted by the New York Times in August 1916. The witnesses have seen thousands of deported Armenians under tents in the open, in caravans on the march, descending the river in boats and in all phases of their miserable life. Only in a few places does the government issue any rations, and those are quite insufficient. The people, therefore, themselves are forced to satisfy their hunger with food begged in that scanty land or found in the parched fields. Naturally, the death rate from starvation and sickness is very high and is increased by the brutal treatment of the authorities, whose bearing toward the exiles as they are being driven back and forth over the desert is not unlike that of slave drivers. With few exceptions, no shelter of any kind is provided, and the people coming from a cold climate are left under the scorching desert sun without food and water. Temporary relief can only be obtained by the few able to pay officials. Similarly, Major General Friedrich Freiherr Kress von Kressenstein noted that the Turkish policy of causing starvation is an all too obvious proof, if proof was still needed as to who is responsible for the massacre. For the Turkish resolve to destroy the Armenians, 350 German engineers and laborers involved in building the railway also witnessed Armenians being crammed into cattle cars and shipped along the railroad line. Franz Gunther, a representative for Deutsche Bank which was funding the construction of the Baghdad Railway, forwarded photographs to his directors and expressed his frustration at having to remain silent amid such bestial cruelty. 326 Major General Otto von Lossow, acting military attaché and head of the German military plenipotentiary in the Ottoman Empire, spoke to Ottoman intentions. In a conference held in Batum in 1918, the Turks have embarked upon the total extermination of the Armenians in Transcaucasia. Armenians who had survived the deportations to their ultimate point. This network, situated in the region of Turkey's present-day borders with Iraq and Syria, was directed by Sukru Kaya, one of Talat Pasha's right-hand men. Some of the camps were only temporary transit points. Others, such as Radjo, Katma, and Azaz, were briefly used as mass graves and then vacated by autumn 1915. Camps such as Lale, Tefrij, Dipsi, Del El, and Raz al-Ain were built specifically for those whose life expectancy was just a few few days, according to Hilmar Kaiser, the Ottoman authorities refused to provide food and water to the victims, increasing the mortality rate, and Muslim men obtained Armenian women through recorded marriages, while the deaths of their husbands were not recorded. Bernau, an American citizen of German descent, traveled to the areas where Armenians were incarcerated and wrote a report that was deemed factual by Rossler. The German consul at Aleppo, he reports mass graves containing over 60,000 people in Meskin and large numbers of mounds of corpses. As the Armenians died due to hunger and disease, he reported seeing 450 orphans, who received at most 150 grams of bread per day, in a tent of 5 to 6 square meters. Dysentery swept through the camp and days passed between the instances of distribution of bread to some in Abu Herrera, near Meskin. He described how the guards let 240 Armenians starve, and wrote that they searched horse droppings for grains, confiscation of property. See also, confiscated Armenian property in Turkey. The Tesser law brought some measures regarding the property of the deportees, but in September a new law was proposed by means of the Abandoned Properties Law. Law concerning property, departments and assets left behind deported persons, also referred as the Temporary Law on Expropriation and Confiscation. The Ottoman government took possession of all abandoned Armenian goods and properties. Ottoman parliamentary representative Ahmed Riza protested this legislation. It is unlawful to designate the Armenian assets as abandoned goods for the Armenians. The proprietors did not abandon their properties voluntarily, they were forcibly, compulsorily removed from their domiciles and exiled. Now the government, through its efforts, is selling their goods. Fundraising poster for the American Committee for Relief in the Near East. See also, American Committee for Armenian and Syrian Relief. The American Committee for Armenian and Syrian Relief, ACASR, also known as Near East Relief, established in 1915 just after the deportations began, was a charitable organization established to relieve the suffering of the peoples of the Near East. The organization was championed by Henry Morgenthau Sr., American ambassador to the Ottoman Empire. Morgenthau's dispatches on the mass slaughter of Armenians galvanized much support for the organization in its first year. The ACRNE cared for 132,000 Armenian orphans from Tiflis, Yerevan, Constantinople, Shivas, Beirut, Damascus, and Jerusalem. A relief organization for refugees in the Middle East helped donate over $102 million budget, $117 million to Armenians both during and after the war, 336 between 1915 and 1930. ACRNE distributed humanitarian relief to locations across a wide geographical range, eventually spending over 10 times its original estimate and helping around 2 million refugees. The Special Organization main article, Special Organization Ottoman Empire. The Committee of Union and Progress founded the Special Organization Turkish Teşkilat-ı İmaz USA that participated in the destruction of the Ottoman Armenian community. This organization adopted its name in 1913 and functioned like a special forces outfit, and it has been compared by some scholars to the Nazi Einsatzgruppen. 182,185. Later in 1914, the Ottoman government influenced the direction the special organization was to take by releasing criminals from central prisons to be the central elements of this newly formed special organization, according to the Mazar commissions attached to the tribunal. As soon as November 1914, 124 criminals were released from Pimian prison little by little. From the end of 1914 to the beginning of 1915, hundreds, then thousands of prisoners were freed to form the members of this organization. Later, they were charged to escort the convoys of Armenian deportees. Vehib Pasha, commander of the Ottoman Third Army, called those members of the special organization the butchers of the human species. Massacres, mass burnings. Morgenthau's caption, those who fell by the wayside. Scenes like this were common all over the Armenian provinces in the spring and summer months of 1915. Death in its several forms, massacre, starvation, exhaustion, destroyed the larger part of the refugees. The Turkish policy was that of extermination under the guise of deportation. Eitan Belkind was a Nili member who infiltrated the Ottoman army as an official. He was assigned to the headquarters of Kemal Pasha. He claims to have witnessed the burning of 5,000 Armenians, 181,183. Lieutenant Hasan Maruf of the Ottoman army describes how a population of a village were taken all together and then burned. The commander of the Third Army, Vihib's 12-page affidavit, which was dated 5 December 1918, was presented in the Trabzon trial series. The 29 March 1919 included in the key indictment, reporting such a mass burning of the population of an entire village near Meuse. The shortest method for disposing of the women and children concentrated in the various camps was to burn them. Further, it was reported that Turkish prisoners who had apparently witnessed some of these scenes were horrified and maddened at remembering the sight. They told the Russians that the stench of the burning human flesh permeated the air for many days after. Vahakan Dadrian wrote that 80,000 Armenians in 90 villages across the Meuse plain were burned in stables and haylofts. Drowning. Trabzon was the main city in Trabzon province. Oscar S. Heiser, the American consul at Trabzon, reported, this plan did not suit Nail Bey. Dadrian places the number of Armenians killed in the Trabzon province by drowning at 50,000. The Trabzon trials reported Armenians having been drowned in the Black Sea. According to a testimony, women and children were loaded on boats in Degermendir to be drowned in the sea. Hoffman Philip, the American chargé d'affaires at Constantinople, wrote, boat loads sent from Zor down the river arrived at Anna, 130 miles away, with three-fifths of passengers missing. According to Robert Fisk, 900 Armenian women were drowned in Bitlis, while in Erzincan, the corpses in the Euphrates resulted in a change of course of the river for a few hundred meters. Dadrian also wrote that countless Armenians were drowned in the Euphrates and its tributaries. Use of poison and drug overdoses. The psychiatrist Robert J. Lifton writes in a parenthesis when introducing the medical experiments during the Holocaust, perhaps Turkish doctors, in their participation in the genocide against the Armenians, come closest, as I shall later suggest, morphine overdose. During the Trabzon trial series of the Martial Court, from the sittings between 26 March and 17 May 1919, the Trabzon's Health Services Inspector Dr. Zia Fuad wrote in a report that Dr. Sabe caused the death of children with the injection of morphine. The information was allegedly provided by two physicians, Drs. Ragab and Vihib, both Dr. Sabe's colleagues at Trabzon's Red Crescent Hospital, where those atrocities were said to have been committed. Toxic gas. Dr. Zia Fuad and Dr. Adnan, Public Health Services Director of Trabzon, submitted affidavits reporting cases in which two school buildings were used to organize children and send them to the mezzanine to kill them with toxic gas equipment. Typhoid inoculation. The Ottoman surgeon, Dr. Haydar Simal, wrote, on the order of the Chief Sanitation Office of the Third Army in January 1916, when the spread of typhus was an acute problem, innocent Armenians slated for deportation at Erzincan were inoculated with the blood of typhoid fever patients without rendering that blood inactive. Jeremy Hugh Barron writes, individual doctors were directly involved in the massacres, having poisoned infants, killed children and issued false certificates of death from natural causes. Nazim's brother-in-law Dr. Tevfik Rushdu, Inspector General of Health Services, organized the disposal of Armenian corpses with thousands of kilos of lime over 6 months. He became foreign secretary from 1925 to 1938. Trials. Turkish courts martial. Main article, Turkish courts martial of 1919-20. On the night of 2-3 November 1918 and with the aid of Ahmed Izzet Pasha, the three pashas, which include Mehmed Talat Pasha and Ismail Enver, the main perpetrators of the genocide, fled the Ottoman Empire in 1919. After the Mudros Armistice, Sultan Mehmed VI was ordered to organize courts martial by the Allied administration in charge of Constantinople to try members of the Committee of Union and Progress Cup Turkish, Itahat Taraki, for taking the Ottoman Empire into World War I by January 1919. A report to Sultan Mehmed VI accused over 130 suspects, most of whom were high officials. Sultan Mehmet VI and Grand Vizier Damat Farid Pasha, as representatives of government of the Ottoman Empire during the Second Constitutional Era, were summoned to the Paris Peace Conference by U.S. Secretary of State Robert Lansing on 11 July 1919. Damat Farid Pasha officially confessed to massacres against the Armenians in the Ottoman Empire and was a key figure and initiator of the war crime trials held directly after World War I to condemn to death the chief perpetrators of the genocide. The military court found that it was the will of the CUP to eliminate the Armenians physically, via its special organization. The 1919 pronouncement reads as follows: the court-martial, taking into consideration the above-named crimes, declares, unanimously, the culpability as principal factors of these crimes the fugitives Talat Pasha, former Grand Vizier, Enver Efendi, former War Minister, struck off the register of the Imperial Army, Simal Efendi, former Navy Minister, struck off two from the Imperial Army, and Dr. Nazim Efendi, former Minister of Education, members of the General Council of the Union. They did so owing to the lack of transparency of the Turkish courts-martial. They were held there for 3 years, while searches were made of archives in Constantinople, London, Paris and Washington to find a way to put them in trial. However, the war criminals were eventually released without trial and returned to Constantinople in 1921, in exchange for 22 British prisoners of war held by the government in Ankara, including a relative of Lord Curzon. The government in Ankara was opposed to political power of the government in Constantinople. They are often mentioned as the Malta exiles in some sources. Meanwhile, the peace conference in Paris established the Commission on Responsibilities and Sanctions in January 1919, which was commissioned by United States Secretary of State Robert Lansing. Based on the commission's work, several articles were added to the Treaty of Sèvres. The Treaty of Sèvres had planned a trial in August 1920 to determine those responsible for the barbarous and illegitimate methods of warfare. Result of the lack of an appropriate legal framework with supranational jurisdiction following World War I, no international norms for regulating war crimes existed, due to a legal vacuum in international law. Therefore, contrary to Turkish sources, no trials were ever held in Malta. Trial of Sagaman Telerian. See also, Operation Nemesis on 15 March 1921, former Grand Vizier Talat Pasha was assassinated in the Charlottenburg district of Berlin, Germany, in broad daylight and in the presence of many witnesses. Talat's death was part of Operation Nemesis, the Armenian Revolutionary Federation's codename for their covert operation in the 1920s to kill the planners of the Armenian genocide. The subsequent trial and acquittal of the assassin, Sagaman Telerian, had an important influence on Raphael Lemkin, a lawyer of Polish-Jewish descent who campaigned in the League of Nations to ban what he called barbarity and vandalism. The term genocide, created in 1943, was coined by Lemkin, who was directly influenced by the massacres of Armenians during World War I. 210 Armenian population, deaths, survivors, 1914-1923. Uncovering the bones of Armenians in Dir Ez Zor. Main articles: Ottoman Armenian population, Ottoman Armenian casualties, and Armenian genocide. Survivors. While there is no consensus as to how many Armenians lost their lives during the Armenian genocide, there is general agreement among Western historians that over 500,000. According to the historian Ara Serafian, the population of Armenians should have been approximately 1,700,000 prior to the start of the war. However, that number had plunged to 284,157 2 years later in 1917. Justin McCarthy calculated an estimate of the pre-war Armenian population, then subtracted his estimate of survivors, arriving at a figure of a little less than 600,000 for Armenian casualties for the period 1914-1922. In a more recent essay, he projected that if the Armenian records of 1913 were accurate, 250,000 more deaths should be added, for a total of 850,000. However, McCarthy's numbers have been highly contested by many specialists. Some of them, like Frederick Paulin, have severely criticized McCarthy's methodology and suggest that it is flawed. Hilmar Kaiser, another specialist, has made similar claims, as have Professor Vahakan Dadrian and Professor Levon Marashlian. These critics not only question McCarthy's methodology and resulting calculations, but also his primary sources, the Ottoman censuses. They point out that there was no official census undertaken in 1912, rather the numbers quoted were based on the records of 1905, which were conducted during the reign of Sultan Hamid. While Ottoman censuses claimed an Armenian population of 12 million, Faiz el-Ghassein, the Kaymakam of Karpout, wrote that there were about 19 million Armenians in the Ottoman Empire, and some modern scholars estimate over 2 million. German official Max Erwin,